Hey everyone, welcome back. Professor Hank here. So today we're going to take a look at a couple of functions in the C++ standard template library that will allow us to sort and to search containers using iterators. So as it turns out, many common algorithms are implemented as function templates in the standard template library. And so these are going to be able to perform operations on a sequence of elements that are denoted by two iterators. So to access these, we're going to need to include algorithm, and that will provide for several different types of function templates for sorting and searching. But today we're just going to examine two, which is going to be the sort function and the binary search function. All right, so as you're going to see, this is actually pretty easy to do. So we're going to need to hashtag include algorithm, and that will give us access to our sort function and to our binary search function. Now, there are more versions of these things, different types of sorts and searches, but we're just gonna look at the two. So we'll use a vector as our container for this example. So let's create a vector of, I don't know, just say integers. And we'll call this V, and we'll initialize it with some values using an initialization list. Now, if we were to print out the contents of this vector right now, it'd be an 8675309, right? So we'll do a range-based for loop for this, and then we will display the contents of our vector separated by spaces, and we'll move the cursor to the next line there. So let's go ahead and test, make sure what we've got is correct so far. So you can see there's the 8675309. So now what I want to do is I want to sort that container. I want to sort that vector. So that's where the sort function is going to come in. So we're going to call it, and we're going to pass as arguments the beginning iterator and the end iterator in our vector. So we'll just do something like this. We'll say v.begin and then v.end. Okay, and that's it. I mean, that is literally it. So sort function takes two iterators as arguments. The part of the container that you want to sort. So I want to sort the entire thing. So I'm going to say beginning and end. So it'll sort all of the values within the container. Now, if I wanted to sort a subset, well, then I could point my iterators at that subset, and then it would just sort that part. So it's kind of a powerful tool to be able to sort in different types of ways. But anyway, so we'll run that, and then we will print out our vector one more time just to see that it in fact did work. So let's go ahead and run that. So now you can see there's the original vector in its original state, and then there's our vector after we ran our sort function or sort algorithm. It's just that easy. All right, now let's take a look at the binary search function. Now, the binary search function does what it's named. It's going to do a binary search. Now, remember that with a binary search, you have to sort the container with a list of values before you run the binary search. That is a requirement in order for it to work. So we'll go ahead and do our sort again. So v.begin and v.end. And then we need to do this first. Now we can do our binary search. So binary search is going to work very similar to how the sort works. It's just we're going to have a third argument, and that third argument is going to be the value that you're actually searching for. So the thing is going to return true if the value is found, false otherwise. So we'll put this inside of an if statement. We'll do if binary search, and then where we're going to start our search. So we'll start at the very, very beginning, and we'll search our entire container in this example. So we'll go all the way to the end, and then we'll look for value 3 in this example. So we'll do cout found, or if it doesn't find what we're looking for, then we'll do cout not found. So it's really just that easy. I mean, there's not a whole lot to these things, and you can see that we actually have the found. Now, if I was to search for something that wasn't in my container, like say -1, then you're going to see that it was not found. So yeah, I mean, it is really that easy. You just specify for both of these functions the starting point and the ending point using the iterators. And in the case of the binary search, you specify also what value you're looking for. So in addition to sorting primitives, we can also sort our own custom objects. So let's go ahead and create a class named food to demonstrate this. And we'll just have it store an integer, which I'll call x. And then I'll include a public interface that contains a constructor named foo. And it'll simply assign to x its argument, so x equals I. Now for the sorting algorithm to work, it has to be able to do comparisons against each item within the container. So how are we going to do a comparison with our own objects? We have to overload the less than operator. So we'll go ahead and do that. We'll do bool operator less than, and then we'll pass by reference a foo object, and we'll call this right hand side. And we'll just simply have it compare the x variables against each other and return that result. So less than RHS dot x. Okay, so now let's create a vector that stores foo objects. So we'll do vector foo v, and we'll have an initialization list here. So we'll do foo 8, we'll do foo 6, and we'll do foo 7. Now I'm going to need to be able to display the contents of those. So we'll add to our public interface here a get method. So we'll just have int get, and we'll return the x. So now that we have that, we can run our sort algorithm. So we'll do sort v.begin, v.end, and then I'll step through the vector calling the get method for each of the objects in the vector so we can see that it in fact did get sorted. So we'll just do for auto f v, and we'll do cout f.get. Okay, and then we're going to see that everything is sorted. It's going to be 6, 7, 8 in the output. So it works just like that. So can we use our binary search function with our own objects? Yes, we can. So we'll have binary search, just like before, and we'll specify the starting point and the ending point, just like we did before. But this time we'll use constant iterators because we're just searching. We're not going to be modifying the contents of the container. So let's double protect ourselves by using the non-mutable version of the iterator. So we'll do v.cbegin, v.cend, and then as our third argument, what we'll do is we will create a temporary object that we can use to compare against one of the objects that are inside of our vector. So if I want to search for the object that contains 6 within our vector, I'm going to do something like that. Okay. And we'll put that inside of an if statement. And if it's found, we'll see out found. Otherwise, we will see out not found. Not found. So it's just that easy. Nothing too complicated there. Just this is kind of weird that we're creating this temporary object, but that's the way this works. So let's test it. So you can see we did find it. There's the found. And then if we wanted to search for an object that contains a value that is not in our container, then you know, we do a similar kind of thing. We're just specifying here's the value that we're searching for, the foo object that contains this particular value. And you'll see it says not found. Again, this is doing a member-wise comparison here. So we didn't need to have a less than here because it's just doing a straight comparison against this value here. But if we needed to do something more complicated, let's say we had an object that was implementing a linked list or something like that, then we would want to also implement our equals equals here. So something like this, then we would customize the logic for what it means for one object to be similar to the other. I mean, you would do this for less than if it's a more complicated object as well. So there you go. So that's everything we wanted to cover in this video. So what did we talk about? We talked about the binary search and the sort function template that is found in the algorithms header file in the standard template library. We saw examples of how to use it with primitives and also examples of how to use them using our own objects. As usual, if you're a student of mine, you have any questions about any of the content in this video or any of the videos in our courses, feel free to stop by my online Zoom office hours or to contact me via Canvas. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you next time.